Good morning and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee in Session 5. I'd like to remind members of the public to turn off mobile phones, and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers during the meeting should ensure they're turned to silent. No apologies have been received today. Our first item of business is a decision on taking item 4 in private. Item 4 is consideration of a paper on the committee's scrutiny of the draft budget 2017-18. Are members agreed? Right. We now move on to our second item of business today, which is an evidence session on the implications of the EU referendum for Scotland. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting the Right Honourable David Mundell, MP, Secretary of State for Scotland, and James Dowler, Deputy Director for Constitutional Policy at the Scotland Office. Welcome. And I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Mundell to make a few opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to begin by thanking the committee for inviting me today to contribute to your inquiry. The UK government is committed to engaging widely and hearing a range of views and perspectives as we prepare for the negotiations with the EU. The evidence gathered by this committee will be an important contribution to that. I also welcome the opportunity to talk to the committee about the work of the UK government has taken forward in the last 4 months since the EU referendum. As the Prime Minister made clear immediately after the referendum, the UK government is committed to getting the best deal for Scotland and the whole of the United Kingdom, and that's exactly what we're focused on. I'm pleased that there have been a series of useful meetings between the UK and Scottish ministers and officials. For example, last Friday, the Secretary of State for Exiting the European Union and I had a very productive discussion with the Minister for EU negotiations on Scotland's place in Europe. On Monday, the Prime Minister chaired a substantive discussion on EU exit with the First Minister and leaders of the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive at the Joint Ministerial Plenary Committee. And yesterday, Mr. Davis and Mr. Russell spoke again. While we may have different views, it's vital that the UK and Scottish governments work constructively together to secure Scotland's interests. That's why the Prime Minister has established a new forum on EU negotiations, chaired by the Secretary of State for Exiting the EU. This will give the Scottish Government and other devolved administrations a direct line to David Davis to allow them to put forward their proposals and help shape the UK's exit strategy. The first meeting is in early November, when market access will be discussed. As the agreement of this new forum demonstrates, we'll give the Scottish Government every opportunity to have their say as we prepare for negotiations with the EU. I welcome that the Scottish Government has signalled that they will publish details of their priorities and proposals in the coming weeks. I also hope the UK and Scottish Governments will take forward some joint engagement on sectors of particular importance to Scotland. And I've proposed that directly to Mike Russell, that is as something that we can take forward in early course. My priority is to ensure that Scottish voices and interests are at the centre of the negotiations to come, and the UK Government is committed to engaging widely across Scotland. My colleague Lord Dunlop and I have already held over 50 meetings with groups and sectors from all parts of Scotland to hear directly from them about their priorities. Organisations include the National Farmers Union, Scottish Fishermen's Federation, the Scottish Retail Consortium, Scottish Whisky Association, Church of Scotland, Law Society, Young People's Representatives, and a range of organisations from energy and tourism sectors. David Davis and I also had an extremely useful meeting with representatives from business, law and culture during his visit to Scotland last week. The overriding message we've heard is a desire for this dialogue to continue, and this will be an ongoing priority as we prepare for negotiations. In the conversations I've had so far, I've also been struck by the appetite there is in Scotland for taking advantage of the opportunities provided by leaving the EU. In particular, the EU will provide many opportunities for the UK to create new trading links and partnerships. As we develop these partnerships, it's of course vital that the people of Scotland and its wide range of businesses are given every opportunity to contribute to the process. I'm grateful to the committee for its work. I look forward to your conclusions with interest and to the continued engagement with the Scottish Parliament, which the UK Government is committed to as we work to leave the EU.
Thank you very much, Secretary of State. Before we move to questions, can I remind members that we only have an hour today, so in order for every member to get the opportunity to ask the Secretary of State questions, if we could just bear that in mind. I'd like to open, Secretary of State, by just basically quoting something that you said on the 7th of August after meeting Scottish stakeholders. You said it was your task to ensure that Scottish voices and interests are at the heart of negotiations. Now, on the 4th of October, we heard the membership of the Prime Minister's Brexit Cabinet Committee, and you're not a member, but you'll only attend as required. So I wondered how you can represent the voices and interests of those Scottish stakeholders when you're only attending this key committee as required.
I am, of course, Ms. McAlpine, a member of the Cabinet, and it will be the Cabinet and the Prime Minister that lead the negotiating process. This is an important committee which covers a range of issues, and as your inquiry has established, there's a vast range of issues that come up in relation to leaving the EU. My purpose is to focus on those issues which are most important to Scotland, and therefore I will attend that committee when issues that are most relevant to Scotland are on the agenda.
For that, I understand it. According to the Cabinet's manual, the committees of the Cabinet have the same authority as the Cabinet. But I wonder if you could tell me how many meetings of that subcommittee there have been?
We've said we're not going to give a running commentary on the negotiations. We're not going to give a running commentary on the committees. But what I can say is the committee is meeting next week and I will be there in attendance.
You will be there. And this as required, who decides when you're required?
What we'll determine is what the agenda is of the meeting, what the range of issues that are on the agenda, what is being discussed, what I consider to be the relevance to Scotland and the importance to Scotland. And if there are matters of importance to Scotland on the agenda of that committee, I will be there.
So you will decide if you're required?
I will determine whether I need to attend that committee.
Right. Can you perhaps give an illustration of when you think this committee would be discussing something that doesn't require your presence?
I think, as I've indicated to you, that there is a vast amount of issues that relate to leaving the EU. What we have to ensure in that process is that we have focus. It's not for me to replicate the role of the Secretary of State for exiting the EU. My role is to ensure that the issues and concerns of Scotland are at the heart of that process. Now, there are many issues that affect Scotland that also affect the whole of the rest of the United Kingdom. And I have every confidence, for example, in my colleagues who attend that committee, that they are able to take forward those issues. Of course, we have distinct issues in Scotland. We've probably come on to discuss some of those. But there are a range of issues which impact on Scotland, which impact on the whole of the United Kingdom. And as I say, I have confidence in colleagues to be able to take those issues forward.
One of the issues that I think there's general agreement that is vital to Scotland's interest is being a member of the single market. And on the 13th of July, you said that you wanted to ensure that Scotland got the best deal. And to quote you, you said clearly that involves being part of the single market. Is that still your view?
My view is that we want to maximise our involvement in the single market. That is the objective that the government wants to achieve. But what I've also said, what the Prime Minister's said, is that it is not appropriate to look at existing structures, because going forward, what the UK is looking to achieve is a bespoke deal, a deal that is the best for the UK, including the best for Scotland, but it is bespoke. It's not about having an arrangement that already exists. It's about doing something new and different. And that's the outcome that we're looking for. So I'm looking for an outcome that allows the UK businesses to participate in the single market without tariffs and without barriers.
So you want full membership of the single market in the sense that you want no tariffs or barriers? That's the European negotiators have already said that that's not possible.
What I also know is that we're not going to conduct this negotiation in public, and that European negotiators and everybody under the sun are going to have their two penneth worth as we go through the next 2 years, and we'll read all sorts of quotes from all sorts of people about what's not possible and what is possible. And what we as the UK government is not going to do, we're not going to conduct these negotiations in public. What, as the Prime Minister has set very clearly out, we are focused on the outcomes. Now, obviously, an outcome which maximises our involvement in the single market is a desirable outcome, and that's what we're looking to achieve.
There's a big difference between maximising your involvement in the single market and being in the single market with all the benefits that that brings.
We're leaving the EU, and therefore, in that sense, we will be out with the current EU structures. What the negotiations will determine is what our relationship will be with those EU structures. And all those issues, as far as I am concerned, as far as the UK government is concerned, is open for negotiation.
I'll pass on to Lewis MacDonald. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'd be eager to explore a little further what you mean when you talk about a bespoke agreement, because clearly that's what we're all focused on, is what the outcomes are going to be. And a bespoke agreement suggests to me something that's tailored, something that's designed to fit our needs. How will that bespoke design be arrived at? What will be the process for determining what a bespoke agreement might look like?
The process will be the negotiations. Clearly, the Prime Minister set out, and the committee is aware of the timetable for triggering Article 50, when the substantive negotiations will begin. What is envisaged, and David Davis set this out when he was in Scotland last week, is that there would be a single agreement for the whole of the United Kingdom. But that doesn't mean that within that agreement there can't be specific issues that would relate to Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. There won't be a Scotland-only agreement or a Wales-only agreement, Northern Ireland-only agreement. There will be a United Kingdom agreement, but that agreement can include differential arrangements in different parts of the United Kingdom if, as part of the negotiation process, that is seen as to be the best way forward.
Very interesting. And the implication of quite a lot of what the Prime Minister's had to say recently is that that tailoring would be very specific around particular sectors. There's been talk, for example, of the City of London and finance. There's been talk of the car industry in the North and indeed the Midlands of England. What talk has there been around Scotland? What, if the Prime Minister asks you, which I'm sure she does, what is it that Scotland needs out of this process? Where do you start that conversation?
Firstly, I wouldn't believe all the media speculation that it exists around special deals. David Davis confirmed when we met businesses in Glasgow last week, there isn't currently a plan for a special deal for the city or for the car industry. There will be issues that those industries have, very specific industries. We know that there are issues in relation to the financial services around passporting, for example. So there are very specific issues to specific industries, but there won't be special deals, and it's absolutely wrong to characterise a suggestion that somehow certain areas or parts of the country will get a special deal and Scotland will not. What will happen for Scotland is that we will get the deal that we need to meet our interests and concerns. Now, I've been engaged myself along with my colleague Lord Dunnell, in over 50 discussions with all sorts of sectors across Scotland. I think a fairly wide cross section, as well as a geographic cross section, because in Scotland that is it's particularly important that we ensure that the whole geography of Scotland incorporated. And what I'm doing at the moment is I've fed back to the Prime Minister, for example, the issues and concerns that come up in that process. But as I indicated in my initial remarks to the conveners, a number of issues that impact on Scotland also impact on other parts of the United Kingdom. So there are other sparsely populated, for example, there are other sparsely populated areas of the United Kingdom where there would be a desire for in-migration. There are areas of the United Kingdom where seasonal agricultural work is important as well as here in Scotland, for example. So that those sort of issues need to be dealt, you know, can be dealt with on a UK-wide basis, whilst at the same time very much dealing with a specific Scottish issue.
When you responded, when you began the answer, that answer, Secretary of State, you used the phrase "special deal." That wasn't the phrase I'd used. I'd simply been.
I know you didn't, Mr. MacDonald, but I have seen that phrase bandied about.
I was seeking to understand your own phrase, which was differential arrangements.
Uh-huh.
What do differential arrangements mean, for example, in relation to financial services, for example, in relation to fisheries, for example, in relation to the motor industry? How do these differential arrangements arrive as part of that bespoke package?
Well, how they arrive is as part of our ongoing discussion and dialogue with these sectors to identify exactly what the most important issues and concerns are for the sector, so that we can understand the importance and the prioritisation they have on particular issues, and feed that into determining the negotiating process.
Clearly, when it comes to designing that, to reaching that conclusion, the role of the person or persons determining which of those differential arrangements are in the package becomes absolutely critical. And so I guess I return to the convener's line of questioning around your role and how it is that the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament can be reassured about your engagement in finalising the stitching together of those differential arrangements into that wider package.
Well, ultimately, we're all judged on what we achieve and what the final outcome is. But I give you an absolute assurance, I am committed to ensuring that Scotland's best interests are achieved in this deal. I think that we can get a deal that can both represent the best interests of Scotland and of the United Kingdom as a whole. And I'm positive about that. I'm going into this process on a positive basis to ensure that our issues and concerns are right up at the top of the agenda. But clearly, the other, as I've indicated, a lot of issues and concerns that we face in Scotland are issues which are evident across the whole of the United Kingdom and need to be resolved on that basis.
Thank you very much. Just one other point. The European Commission, in setting the grounds on which Michel Barnier is to negotiate from the other side of the table, has specifically picked out Northern Ireland and Gibraltar as territories where a particular approach requires to be taken. Would you like to put on the record your understanding of what that means? What is it that requires the European Commission to approach discussions around Northern Ireland and Gibraltar on a different basis from the discussions around the other component parts of the United Kingdom?
The specific issue is, of course, that both those areas have a land border with European Union member states.
And is there not also a legal aspect to this, particularly in relation to other treaty obligations the UK has undertaken?
There are specific issues in both cases, but the geography is also a significant element in that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Did you have a supplementary, if you could just be as quick as possible?
Secretary of State, in terms of the different asks that are going to be conveyed to the UK government from around the UK, in Scotland our position is different. We have a government of our own with a policy position. We have a parliament and we have 62% of the population who voted to remain within the European Union. And you are, after all, Scotland's voice in the UK cabinet, therefore I assume it's Scotland's priorities at the foremost of your mind. Do you therefore agree that Scotland does have a distinctive case and a voice to be heard in these negotiations, especially in relation to access and membership of the single market, and it would be unacceptable if these needs were not taken into account in asks by the UK government?
Scotland has two governments. It has a government here, the devolved government, and it is part of the United Kingdom and is represented by the United Kingdom government. Scotland gets the best deal when those two governments work together in a team UK approach. That's what I am committed to achieving. I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that all the issues, concerns, asks of the Scottish Government are part of developing our negotiating process. I'm pleased that we've made progress. And you've previously yourself, Mr. Lockhead, been involved in the workings of the joint ministerial committees, and you know how challenging it can be to bring all three devolved administrations, UK government, together. So it's taken slightly longer than I would have hoped. But we've got a process now which will allow the Scottish government and Scottish government officials as well behind the scenes to be right at the heart of the process. And I think, you know, we've got the first meeting of that joint ministerial committee European negotiations coming up in early November. Market access, an issue that we've already touched on, will be on the agenda. There's a lot of work going on to determine the work programme for that. So I don't have any doubt that Scotland's issues, concerns, asks will be at the heart of this process.
Jackson Carlo.
Secretary of State, that kind of leads slightly and covers slightly the area I'd like you to discuss, and that is to say a little bit more about the formal structures that are going to underpin the engagement that will take place between the Scottish Government and Westminster, and the Scottish Parliament, indeed, and Westminster. How would you characterise the outcome of the meeting that took place on Monday? Just the formal structures that you've alluded to, what you think they will depend upon in order for there to be a productive and successful dialogue and outcome. And you've mentioned the fact that market access will be on the agenda, although you don't propose to give a running commentary. But is that in itself a reflection of the importance that has been attached to that issue by the devolved administrations who have been seeking to identify the areas that will be discussed?
Obviously, goodwill is at the heart of any process where parties are working together. I have to say that I've had a very, very positive working relationship with Mr. Russell to date. Obviously, I know Mr. Russell well of old, and he has acted in a very constructive manner to date. That's why I'm very keen, following a discussion that we had recently, that we engage in some joint activity. I think it's very important to do that, the two governments doing that together. There's little point in me, in evidence gathering, so to speak, and finding that we have contradictory evidence, for example. Let's work together and see what the sectors are saying. Let's share information. And that's very much what this process is about. It's about both bringing officials together, but importantly, bringing the political part of the government together as well. The committee will meet regularly, probably monthly. It will meet throughout the process of the negotiations and will be, it will discuss the negotiations as the negotiations proceed. Obviously, in the period up until the end of March, when the Prime Minister has set out that Article 50 will be triggered, its focus will be on that process and the beginning of the negotiations. But there will be full and frank discussion. I have no doubt about that, but I also don't have any doubt that the Scottish Government voice will be heard in the process.
And just the point I asked about the fact that market access is to be on the agenda of this, the first meeting that's coming up, does that reflect the priority that's been attached to that by the devolved administrations? Is that why it's there? And how do you sort of see the work programme of that group developing?
The work programme is going to be brought together by the respective administrations. There's a lot of detailed work going on in relation to achieve that, because it is a very tight timetable to work to. But And what the Prime Minister has assured the First Minister and others is that the timetable of that committee will, you know, will dovetail into other developments. So the committee will discuss, for example, the Great Repeal Bill, which the piece of legislation which is proposed that would mean the repeal of the European Communities Act. You know, the committee will discuss that at the point before that is finalised, so that there's full engagement in that process. So we will dovetail the activities of the JMCEN with other developments as they unfold. Both sides and the other devolved administrations believe market access is a very important issue, and I think that's why it's going to be the first issue that's going to be discussed.
Okay, thank you.
On that point, how many meetings of the JMCEN will there take place before Article 50 is triggered?
I can't answer that question in a definitive way. At the moment, it's anticipated that the committee would meet on a monthly basis. But if more meetings are required, then there's a flexibility to do that. Likewise, there's flexibility to have, you know, to have less meetings. What is also proposed, and I am very, very supportive of this, because I do think that it was most unfortunate that the JMCP, which is the meeting of First Ministers and the Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland with the Prime Minister, you know, took so long to come about. There were a whole range of administrative reasons from all sides that didn't happen. But it's been agreed that will meet more regularly, and that there'll be a meeting of that forum early in the new year as well.
Right. If it was monthly, then you're talking about four meetings before Article 50 is triggered. So that doesn't sound all that many to me.
If the participants want to have more meetings, there isn't a restriction on the number of meetings. I'm just reporting what the envisaged timescale is.
Okay, thank you very much. Tavish Scott.
One supplementary, if I may, convener, on the process points that have been discussed. Can I take it that when Article 50 is triggered, Secretary of State, there will be a UK position?
There will be a UK position going into the negotiations, but that position in specific terms will not be announced in the sense of a running commentary basis that I've alluded to, or the sense of us making absolutely clear what our negotiating position was on issues. I think what you can anticipate, because there will be the process of triggering Article 50 will involve a communication with the EU, and that will set out UK priorities.
No, I understand that, and believe me, I have heard the phrase running commentary more than I'd ever want to hear it ever again. But what I was driving at is, it is therefore safe to assume that at that point that Article 50 is triggered, Edinburgh, Cardiff and Belfast will know what that position is.
I would anticipate, yeah. Yes.
Okay, thank you. The question I actually wanted to ask was on environment, fisheries and agriculture. When we came into this place in 1999, as Richard and Lewis did too, when I read the Scotland Act at that point, they're devolved. In whatever happens in the future, they'll remain devolved, won't they? Fisheries, agriculture and environment will be the responsibility of this institution.
There'll be no change to existing arrangements, other than in the context of leaving the EU, does automatically change the devolved settlements, because the devolved settlements are based or predicated on the basis that the UK is a member of the EU. So it is clear that there will be a range of changes flowing from that in terms of relationship, and a range of options. What I'm committed to do in relation to those options is to engage with all those interested parties in Scotland. I think it's very important we do that. That's what we've done in relation to previous devolution settlements, both back in the settlement that preceded the establishment of this Parliament, the Calman Commission and the Smith Commission. All of those were heavily consulted on and proceeded on the basis of engagement. So I'm not proceeding at the moment on the basis of a fixed presumption. Mm-hmm. I very much understand the point that you make. You will be aware, you know, that there are other interests that suggest different options. I think we need to look at the options and engage fully. And that's what I'm committed to do.
I understand that, but politically it would be impossible to imagine a fisheries policy for Scotland being determined in Westminster, given it's been determined in Edinburgh by no other than Richard Lockhead for the last, and for that matter Ross Finney, for the last, since devolution in 1999.
I couldn't envisage that there would be a change to the existing arrangements.
No. Okay, thank you.
Okay, on that point, you'll be aware, Secretary of State, that this committee commissioned research work, from Professor Alan Page at Dundee University, and he made the point that after Brexit, there was a possibility, a very strong possibility, that Scottish law, which was European law, could be repealed using secondary legislation at Westminster, abandoning the presumption that there would be consultation with this Parliament. Do you envisage that we'll have to go back into the devolution settlement to make sure that that doesn't happen?
What I envisage happening in relation to the Scots law issues is obviously the two governments working very closely together to ensure that there are no legal difficulties. Firstly, at the point that the UK leaves the EU, that there is that the body of existing EU law applies from that day, so we don't reach a situation where there is any uncertainty as to what the law is, and that will be a key component of the Great Repeal Bill. And there's already been discussions with the Scottish Government's, initial discussions with Scottish Government's legal advisers as to how that process can be best taken forward. And because it is a complex process, and that process will go forward on the basis of cooperation. There's no suggestion that laws that have been passed here in Holyrood would in some way be overridden by decisions taken at Westminster.
Right, because it's not a matter of between the two governments. I think the point that Professor Page was making is that this Parliament should always have scrutiny, and there shouldn't be an arrangement where using secondary legislation laws can be changed without consulting this Parliament.
I'm very happy, Ms. McAlpine, to give you an undertaking that no laws will be changed of the type that you refer to without consultation, with this Parliament. And we want to now work through the process, because there are a whole. I think, as Professor Page would allude to, there are a whole range of instruments that may have passed which make reference to the EU, which may need to be changed, and we need to find a way in which that is done. Not in a way that changes the substance of what they do, but just to ensure their continuing validity.
Okay. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Secretary of State. I've heard a few things this morning from yourself, such as that you want to maximise involvement in the single market and looking for a bespoke deal. But I'm a bit unsure, certainly just in terms of the whole issue of free movement, but can you tell me what your current position is, please, on whether you do support or don't support free movement to Scotland?
What I support is that it will be for the United Kingdom to determine who enters the United Kingdom from the European Union. So there are two elements to this process. One is bringing back the control of immigration from the EU to the United Kingdom. And then the second part of that is determining what policies that we have within the United Kingdom in relation to who comes to the United Kingdom.
This week, I attended the Crossmarty Group in Science and Technology event on Tuesday evening. And at that meeting, it was suggested, it was highlighted that 16% of academics in the UK are from the EU, 12% of academics are non-EU. Last night, I attended the RCN event here in the Parliament, and it was put to me that 33,000 NHS nurses alone are non-UK. Mm-hmm. And also this week, we heard from Professor Sir Timothy O'Shea indicating that Brexit ranges from bad to awful to being catastrophic. Mm-hmm. And from a Scottish perspective, we have the last year, in 2015, the first marine tourism strategy was published. And that's about really kind of promoting and increasing the tourism opportunity across Scotland for sailing and boating. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the aspects of that is about encouraging people to come from elsewhere, particularly Northern Europe, other EU member states. So if we don't have free movement, notwithstanding the academics, the nurses, and also the other elements in terms of students and other academia through universities, as well as the range of boating and sailing activities, how are we going to really fully benefit if we don't have free movement?
I think that, well, I think they're two separate points. As I've said, the objective in the negotiations is to return control of immigration from the EU to the UK so that we can determine ourselves who comes to the UK from the EU. We already have, you know, existing immigration arrangements in place for non-EU citizens. It doesn't mean that we're going to go from a position of having a very significant number of people come from the EU to having no people. There are already all sorts of criteria that currently exist, particularly in relation to specified occupations where there is a shortage of skills. And that I think, certain to continue. So it will be about establishing our own immigration system in relation to the EU. I have this week or last week participated in the inquiry which your colleagues, Westminster colleagues, on the Scottish Affairs Select Committee are currently pursuing about inward migration to Scotland. And I think that is a very a worthwhile and significant inquiry, because one of the things that's clear at the moment is that of the people who currently come to the United Kingdom, in rough terms, only 3 or 4% of those people come to Scotland. So a very, very small number of people who are coming to the United Kingdom come to Scotland. And we need to understand why that might be, how we can go about making Scotland a more attractive place for people to want to come to. I think that's a fundamental part of it. But in relation to your question, there is no intention to stop people coming completely from the European Union. What we will have is our own immigration system to determine who comes.
Well, I'm sure Secretary of State, if you want to speak to a family in the Highlands, they'll tell you why they wanted to come to Scotland. But secondly, just in terms of the boating and the sailing aspect, are you suggesting, therefore, if we're going to have our own separate immigration system, that there's a potential that we could then see some type of border controls at the marinas, not just in Scotland, but across the UK?
In terms of in terms of border controls, I would hope that we don't have to have border controls at marinas across Scotland. I want people to come here, but we also have to ensure that we don't have, as at the moment, we don't have abuse of the system. As I understand it, for example, your border force keeps a very close eye on all ports within Scotland, just in case people are using those ports to breach the current rules.
Thank you.
A supplementary from Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Secretary. Good morning. It is related to borders. What discussions have you had with colleagues for Northern Ireland over how solutions for the issue of the Ireland and Northern Ireland border will impact on travel, similar to what Stuart McMillan has said, like to and from Northern Ireland, from Stranraer, for instance? Can you guarantee that there will be no border controls at Stranraer?
There are two, I think there are two issues there. Obviously, the common travel area with the Ireland and the rest of the United Kingdom has existed, I think, from about 1923. So it's something that has preceded our membership of the EU and Ireland's membership of the EU, and it's something that the government has made clear that we want to continue. We want to continue to be able to have that the arrangement that currently exists, and I think that clearly is the position of the Irish government as well. So there are detailed discussions which have already begun as to how that can be achieved. If that's achieved, there shouldn't need to be I can't envisage why there would need to be border controls at Stranraer. But as you're aware, you know, over a period, many people have expressed concern about the access to the UK mainland through Stranraer, and that perhaps people had come in through that route who might not have got into the United Kingdom if they had chosen other ways to do so. But we're committed to looking to ensure that the common travel area can stay in place, and detailed discussions are ongoing at the moment as to how that can be achieved.
Just to be clear, do you rule out border controls at Stranraer?
I can't envisage any circumstances in which there would be border controls at Stranraer.
So no border controls in Ireland or between Ireland and Scotland?
That's what we want to ensure, that we can keep the common travel area as it is at the moment. But I can't preempt those negotiations, because they not only obviously involve the UK government and the Irish government, there will be a degree of requirement for the other member states of the EU to agree to such an arrangement. But it is an important component of our discussions currently with between the UK government and Irish government.
Yeah, just on that, clearly you've referred to the common travel agents area and the prospect of continued free movement of people across the Irish border and between Ireland and the United Kingdom. That's quite a different matter from the single market. And does that mean that if we're not members of the single market, that the negotiation must encompass both free movement of people and an end to free movement of goods and services?
I think no one would want to go back to any of the borders of the past that have existed in Ireland, and that it would be an aspiration to ensure that there were none.
Including the movement of goods and
Indeed.
Services.
Okay. Move to Ross Greer now.
Thanks very much, Convener. There seems to be a tension here between the British government's position that it needs to take back control of our borders and the willingness to ensure that there are not border controls. The Irish government yesterday dismissed ideas that there could be essentially British border controls in Dublin, and discussion here of discussions between the two governments. To quote the Taoiseach, we do not yet know what the British government is actually looking for here. There seems to be quite a hard tension to resolve. But to go back to Lewis MacDonald's point, does the UK government accept that to take back control of our own borders, of our own immigration policy, we would have to do so from out with the single market, as has been repeatedly stated to us?
I accept on one level, if we're leaving the EU, then essentially we are leaving the single market. But our access to the single market, I think, can continue in a way that doesn't involve tariffs or barriers, and still be able to control immigration from the EU in this country. Clearly, that's something that we should aspire to achieve as part of these negotiations.
I think that other leaders from the rest of Europe have made it exceptionally clear that the tension between those two points is perhaps unresolvable. But moving on to the economic impact on Scotland, this committee commissioned a paper from the Fraser Valenster Institute looking at the potential economic effects. Its pessimistic scenario had in the region of 80,000 job losses and a £2,000 drop in average wages over the next decade. I was wondering if you could outline a little bit what the UK government's evidence-based approach is to deciding what is in the best interests of the Scottish economy.
I'm pleased to find that not all pessimistic forecasts come to pass, because the forecast for our GDP today was going to be -1, and it's actually plus 0.5.
So, with all due respect, Brexit hasn't started yet.
I think it has, in the sense that the decision's been taken, the process has begun, and impacts are being felt. There are other people who would argue that people are already feeling some impact, some positive, some negative. I think what the GDP figures indicate is that our economy is strong and resilient. There is going to be turbulence. There's no doubt about that. The Chancellor will, in his autumn statement in November, I'm sure, bring forward a number of specific proposals. But I think that we can be confident that we have a strong and resilient economy. And there are difficult circumstances at the moment for some businesses, but other businesses are taking the opportunity of the lower value of the pound. Businesses that agricultural businesses, for example, and tourism businesses, in terms of the number of people who are coming into Scotland and the rest of the UK. So I'm not denying in any way that there's going to be turbulence, but there are also going to be positives as well.
On that note, taking aside the UK government's view on the value of expert advice, the expert advice and forecasting seems to be a debate on the range of how negative the impact is going to be. Even the most optimistic scenarios still had strong negative impacts on our economy. In that case, I can only presume that the UK government believes there are non-economic benefits to Scotland taking part in what seems to be a hard Brexit position that's being adopted. Could you outline what the non-economic benefits are in the UK government's view?
I don't think that terms like hard Brexit and soft Brexit are really relevant. They're bandied around, but actually, as I explained to the convener in my opening remarks, what we are looking for is a bespoke deal for the United Kingdom and for including Scotland that gets us the best possible arrangement. So it's not a hard Brexit or soft Brexit option. It's about getting the best deal, which is outcome based, and that's what the Prime Minister is focused on achieving, and that's what we have to work towards. There'll be lots of noises off. We're going to hear lots of things said by all sorts of European leaders, the European Commissioner, academics, goodness knows who else, about why we can't have this or why we can't have that. But what the deal will be is what is actually achieved in the negotiations, and I'm confident and positive about our ability to achieve a good deal in those negotiations.
I hope we're not sick of that expert advice and the UK government will take it on board.
Well, what I can assure you is that all the contributions, we're aware of all the contributions that have been made to this committee, and I think it's been a very valuable exercise in the sense of the engagement that you've achieved. And obviously we're aware of the views that have come in through that. We're aware of what experts say, but we're also focusing on what real people say and what businesses and organisations across Scotland say.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Rachel Hamilton.
Secretary of State, you spoke in your opening statement about creating new trading links and partnerships, and Theresa May recently set out her vision for Brexit and said a truly global Britain is possible and is in sight. It would be no surprise that it is, because we are the fifth largest economy in the world, and the UK is growing fast in the G7. And it's something we should be proud of. But can you give the committee reassurances that the UK will make Brexit a success to ensure our continued performance on that world stage?
Absolutely. I mean, I think Brexit is an opportunity. It's an opportunity for us to forge a new role on the world stage. It's an opportunity for us to be, I believe, a champion of free trade. I think free trade is a good thing. I think it's concerning some of the language we hear, particularly in the US presidential election, about not supporting free trade. I think we have the opportunity to create new arrangements. I think even those people who are most pro the EU accept that some of the arrangements that it has with other countries which we currently operate under are not the best possible deals that could have been achieved for the UK's interests. So I think there are lots and lots of new arrangements out there. And what really encourages me is that as I go round Scotland and speak to businesses and to other stakeholders, they see these opportunities. They're not, you know, they accept there are challenges, but they see that there are real opportunities for them and their businesses in these new arrangements. And, you know, they're very optimistic and open-minded at looking at them.
Okay. Secondly, Ross Greer mentioned the Fraser Allender Institute, and we recently heard evidence from them at a business breakfast, and they highlighted that the UK is a significantly more vital trading partner for Scotland than the rest of the EU. And Scotland's exports are obviously four times as much with the rest of the UK than they are with the EU. As Secretary of State for Scotland, do you agree that it is important that we prioritise relations with our largest trading partner and do not do anything to jeopardise that?
I absolutely agree. The union with the rest of the United Kingdom, as you say, is of a value of more than four times the value of the EU market for Scotland. Indeed, over the last ten years, between 2004 and 2014, the proportion of Scotland's exports to the EU fell, and the proportion of its exports to the rest of the UK went up. So the rest of the UK is an incredibly important market for Scotland. A million jobs depend on that market. So whilst I absolutely accept the legitimacy of concerns about access to the single EU market, we have to prioritise the market that is most important to us, and that is the rest of the UK.
Thank you. Richard Lockhead.
Thank you. I just want to pick up and where Tavish Scott kind of left off earlier on, given the reference to my former life as fishing minister. And in my experience, we found that we didn't have Scottish fishing quota because the quota was allocated to the UK because it was a member state of the European Union. Also, we were unable to take charge of international negotiations because the UK government deemed that as foreign affairs. So are you saying that if we exit the European Union, there'll be a Scottish quota? And are you also saying that Scotland will be able to conduct our international negotiations over fishing stocks?
What I'm saying is that I'm going to engage on that issue. I'm not. I think I was quite clear in my answer to Mr. Scott. When I'm not proceeding on a presumption. I'm agreeing that there are now issues that have arisen because we have left the EU, that we have begun the process of leaving the EU, and that those issues need to be addressed. And I think the best way to address those issues is through engagement. I think from the way you phrased the question, you have a view as to what the end process of that engagement should be, which may be similar to Mr. Scott. It might not be the same view, for example, of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. You know, it may not be the same view as other interested parties. But I want to ensure that we have that engagement, because that engagement is always what has preceded changes to the arrangements in the devolved settlement.
Okay. Supplementary from Lewis MacDonald.
Yes, thank you. You said, Secretary of State, a moment ago in answer to our previous question, if we are leaving the EU, then we are leaving the single market. Now, you'll be aware that some of our nearest neighbours in Northwest Europe are out with the European Union, but are inside the single market. When you come to discuss with the JMC next month market access, does that mean that the model that's been followed by Norway and Iceland is simply one that will not be considered, or is that something that the UK government is prepared to discuss with the devolved administrations?
It's certainly something that we are prepared to discuss. I would hope that it's not a necessary arrangement, because the access that we've managed to secure for the UK from the single market is what meets Scotland's and the UK's needs. But that is a the Prime Minister was very clear to the First Minister when we met on Monday that all options will be looked at.
So you accept that it's perfectly possible to be within the single market but out with the European Union?
I accept that there are a number of existing arrangements in place. I also accept, however, that we are proceeding for our own bespoke arrangement, which is not the same arrangement that Norway or Switzerland or Iceland or any other country would currently have. But I understand, you know, these arrangements. I've said, indeed, when I met at the very start of this process of engagement, when I met Fiona Hislop, who was then responsible for these matters, on the 24th of June, I said that there was no manual on the shelf to determine how all of this would work, and that we would be open to look at options. That has continued to be the case, and I'm looking forward to, as I understand, the publication imminently of the Scottish Government's proposals, because obviously we want to look at those.
Was the supplementary very quickly from Stuart McMillan and Ross Greer.
Thank you. Secretary of State, just you mentioned in a reply to Rachel Hamilton, you spoke about free trade. But in terms of having a bespoke agreement out of the single market, but having access to the single market, do you therefore think that the UK will still have free trade arrangements with the rest of the EU?
I would envisage that we would want to have that maximum access to the EU single market rather than having individual arrangements with members of the EU.
Yeah. Understand that you can't have individual arrangements
indeed.
With members of the EU.
Indeed, you can.
Very briefly, to follow Rachel Hamilton's question about Scotland's relationship with the rest of the UK, if this Parliament was to decide that that relationship needed re-examined through a referendum, would your government, whilst obviously taking a clear position, be willing to grant the Section 30 order to allow that to take place?
Well, obviously, I don't support there being another referendum held. I believe that the people of Scotland made their decision on the 18th of September 2014, and in accordance with the Edinburgh Agreement, which both governments signed, that decision should be acknowledged. Therefore, in relation to the consultation on the referendum, I feel I think it is unnecessary and unhelpful, and the feedback that I get from most businesses that we go around is they want that issue taken off the table because they believe that it's creating undue uncertainty. But in relation to the specific of your question, the one thing that I acknowledge in that consultation is that it accepts that if another referendum were to be contemplated, then it requires the agreement of the UK government and legislation in the UK Parliament.
And to ask it again, if this Parliament decided that that was to take place, would the UK government grant such a Section 30 order?
What I've just set out is that agreement would be required with the UK government for such a referendum to take place, and legislation would be required in the UK Parliament.
We don't know then.
No such proposal has been brought forward to the UK government.
Okay, thank you very much. Just to conclude, I was interested when you were talking about the GMCEN and you're talking about it dovetailing with other meetings that are happening. Will the devolved administrations have the opportunity to discuss issues of importance to them and put their position out, set it out clearly at the GMCEN before the meetings of this Cabinet Brexit subcommittee?
What is envisaged in terms of developing the work programme is that the work programme is dovetailing with these other important elements of the decision making process. So that's what the objective is. That was fully understood at the GMC. Yeah. It would not serve any purpose, and it wouldn't be productive or helpful to be discussing things that had already proceeded in down a different direction.
It's the earliest possible.
It is attempting to achieve the engagement with the devolved administrations at the point where they can influence what the outcome is.
The actual shape of the deal. So
yes.
Ahead of the cabinet.
Ahead of the whatever processes are going on around it. Yes.
Right, OK. And I think we'll all be very pleased to hear that you are attending the Brexit subcommittee. Is that the first time you've attended the Brexit subcommittee?
I'm not giving a running commentary on the number of a committee, a number of times the committee's met, who's been a present at them. I go back to what I said at the start. I will ensure that Scotland's interests are represented both in terms of what that committee does, both in terms of what the GMCEN does, and in terms of what the Cabinet does.
Right. The Brexit, we do know that this Brexit subcommittee has already met to discuss trade and immigration, which I think we've all agreed are very important issues for Scotland. Were you at that meeting? It sounds as if you haven't been to any of them so far.
Well, I know that I know that you want to draw me into giving a running commentary, which I alluded to with Mr. Scott. I am absolutely satisfied that my role allows me to contribute not just to that committee, but to the Cabinet discussions and to the whole range of other discussions which are taking place, which will ensure that we get Scotland and the UK the best possible deal from this process.
I'm sorry to press you, but you're giving me the very distinct impression that you haven't attended one of these Brexit subcommittees of the Cabinet.
Well, whatever impression I'm giving you, what I'm not giving you is a running commentary on those committees, who attends and what was discussed.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
At that point, we will suspend the meeting and go into private session. Thank you.